Hi, this is Professor Jim A. Chan at California State University, Long Beach. In this video lesson, we'll look at factoring and constructing polynomial functions using the factor theorem. Guess it would only be fair if I tell you what the factor theorem is first. The factor theorem says that x equals c is a zero of a polynomial p of x if and only if x minus c is a factor of p of x. X equals c is a zero of a polynomial p of x means that if I were to evaluate c in the place for x, I should get a zero out, and that's why it's called a zero. X minus c is a factor of p of x means that if I were to factor p of x, it should contain a factor x minus c in it. It could also have some other things in it as well, so all of that stuff is going to be called the quotient. But if x minus c is going to be a factor for this polynomial, it should have a zero remainder when I do this division. For example, if I say f of x is equal to x minus 2 times x plus 3 squared, then I can say that x minus 2 is a factor for f of x. But if there is actually going to be a non-zero remainder, like say 2 here, then I cannot say x minus 2 is a factor for f of x. You have to make sure that you get zero remainder. Let's look at an example next. Here, let p of x be x cubed minus 7x plus 6. Let's show that x minus 1 is a factor for p of x. Well, the factor theorem says that x minus 1 is a factor for p if and only if x equals 1 is a zero for p. Well, to show that x equals 1 is a zero for p, all I need to show is that p evaluated at 1 gives you 0. Well, that shouldn't be too hard to see. If I take 1 cubed minus 7 times 1 plus 6, I indeed get a 0 out. So by the factor theorem, I can say that x minus 1 is a factor for p. Occasionally, you might want to find other factors. In that case, we can perform the long division or the synthetic division to figure out what the other factors are. Here, I'm going to show you how to do it with long division. So we write our polynomial inside. That's going to list the terms in descending order, starting with the highest degree, and that is x cubed. There is no x squared term in this polynomial, so I'm going to do a placeholder of 0x squared. There is a linear term, that's negative 7x, and then the constant term of 6. Do long division, put the divisor, or the actual factor we wanted to divide, outside. In this case, we already found out that x minus 1 is a factor. So when I do this polynomial division with this factor, I should expect to come out with something that's called the quotient, and that's going to be on top. Proceed to ask myself, what should I put in here so that when I multiply this term with x minus 1, I would get an x cubed out? It has to be x squared, because when I do x squared times x, I would get an x cubed out. And when I do x squared times negative 1, I will get a negative 1x squared there. And then subtract those two, we get 0x cubed, which is exactly what I'm trying to accomplish here to get rid of that x cubed term. With the 0x squared minus the negative x squared, I would end up with a positive x squared left. Always want to carry one more term with you because there are two terms in your divisor. Then put down the minus 7x here and then move forward. I ask myself, what do I need to put in here so that when I multiply this term with the x, I will get x squared? Well, the answer has to be x, and that's going to be a positive x. So if I put positive x there, I would then get x squared minus x when I distribute that. Subtract those two again, x squares cancel. I'm left with negative 7x minus the negative x, which leaves me with negative 6x. Again, carry one more term down to match up, so we get plus 6. Now the last question is, what do I need to multiply here so that when I multiply this with the x, I would get negative 6x out? Well, the answer is negative 6. If I put negative 6 there, I distribute a negative 6 into each one of those my divisor, I will get negative 6x plus 6. And that looks exactly the same as what we have there. So when I do subtraction, I should get a 0. This number that you get is called the remainder. In order for something to be a factor of a polynomial, the remainder has to be equal to 0. So this actually verifies that it is a factor. This means I can write my original polynomial p as the factor x minus 1 times this quotient, which is x squared plus x minus 6. And notice that you can actually factor this quotient into 2 and the 3. This actually turns into x minus 1 and x minus 2 times x plus 3. And this is a completely factored form for this polynomial. Again, this is an optional step. If you ever were asked to get all the factors of a polynomial, this is the general step you would take. First, by figuring out one factor and do a long division to get the rest of the factors. Now that we've understood what the factor theorem does, let's see if we can actually use it in more of a reverse way. In this example, I want to find three different polynomials with degree 3 and having zeros at x equals 0 and x equals 5. According to the factor theorem, x minus 0 and x minus 5 must be factors of the desired polynomial. We need to construct a degree 3 polynomial only with two factors here. That means one of the factors need to be raised to a higher power. For example, I can raise the power on the factor x 2 and then leave the x minus 5 factor a power 1. Or I can leave polynomial x with the highest power 1 and raise factor x minus 5 to the power 2. Or I can take whatever I have already as one of them and just change the coefficient in front. Because multiplying a constant to the entire polynomial does not change the degree of that polynomial, which means any polynomial of the form of some constant c times x minus 5 squared would satisfy this condition. You can actually now change c to any number you desire and it would satisfy the condition. Here's another example of a twist of a factor theorem. Here I want to construct a polynomial of degree 3 that has zeros 1, negative 2, and 3, in which the coefficient of x squared is 3. The twist to this is to use what we've learned from before. If I multiply this entire polynomial by a non-zero constant, then it doesn't change the degree of the polynomial, which means there's actually infinitely many polynomials satisfying those zeros. I could come up with a general polynomial and having those three things as the zeros and just kind of play around with the constants there. We want to do that in a more intelligent way. So let's start with the information given. Having those three as the zeros, which means that x minus 1, x plus 2, and x minus 3 have to be the factors of this polynomial. It is a degree 3 polynomial, which means that these are really raised to the power first each. My polynomial has to have those three as the factors, but it could be any coefficient in the front here. So I'm going to just put an a as an unknown coefficient for now. This will have to be determined based on this other information that we're given, which says that the coefficient of x squared has to be 3. Well, the information given to us is about x squared. So let's try to see if we can actually get the x squared term out of this expression here. Leave the a as it is, and then multiplied these two factors first, and that's going to be x squared minus an x plus a 2x, altogether a plus 1x, and the constant term is going to be a minus 2. And I still have the x minus 3 factor there. What we care about is the x squared term. I'm not going to care the result of multiplying the rest of them, only going to care about x squared term. But how do I actually get an x squared term out of this multiplication? X squared is only going to come from taking a x squared times a constant, which is a minus 3x squared. The x squared can also come from multiplying a x with an x. That's a plus x squared. And there's no other way you can going to get an x squared term out of this multiplication problem. So I'm just going to write this as a times the x squared term stuff plus the rest of the stuff that I don't care about. Okay, so if you do this combination, you get negative 2x squared out, but then you still have an a attached to it in the front, so it's this whole thing times an a, which tells you that you really get negative 2ax squared plus the rest of the junk that you don't care about at this point. I'm going to match up with the information given to us. We need to have that coefficient to be 3. So that means my negative 2a has to be equal to 3 per the information. This tells me that negative 2a is 3. I can then solve for a by simply dividing a negative 2 both sides. I'm left with negative 3 halves for my a. So this right away tells you that your polynomial of x has to be negative 3 halves times all the factors, x minus 1, x plus 2, and x minus 3. And learning to do mathematics is also learning what you really need to do to do the least amount of work and still get the correct answer. So this is one very good example of showing you, you really don't need to do all of that work if you, all you want to figure out is what happens to the x squared term. In this next example, this is very similar to what we've just done there. The strategy that we use is very similar. We want to find a formula for the polynomial g of x of degree 4 with zeros at 1, 2, 3, and 4, also passing through the point negative 1, 600. Again, we start with this family of infinitely many polynomials having those zeros in degree 4 by attaching an unknown constant in the front. I'm going to use k here because it's just some unknown number. You can use a, b, c, d, e, f, g. Doesn't really matter. Let's say use k. And we have those as the zeros, which means that x minus 1 has to be a factor, x minus 2 has to be a factor, x minus 3 is a factor, and x minus 4 is also a factor. And that is a direct consequence of the Factor Theorem. It is indeed a degree 4 polynomial if those 4 are the factors. Like I said, there's infinitely many numbers you can use for k, but this polynomial has to pass through this particular point. That means when I evaluate x at negative 1, I should get the y value out at 600. So k is unknown at this point, but if I were to stick in a negative 1 in the place for x, I would then get the quantity negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, and a negative 5. All these are multiplied. So if I take 2 times 3 times 4 times 5, and they're actually 4 numbers, all negatives, eventually the result is going to be positive. And simply multiplying those numbers gives me 120. So this is equal to 120 times k, but I need this value to be at 600 per the problem. So if I set this to 600 because of the instruction given to me, and then solve for k, I will simply just divide it by 120 both sides to get the desired number 5. And that is telling me that my polynomial g of x has to be 5 times x minus 1, x minus 2, x minus 3, and x minus 4. Occasionally, you might want to multiply this out, but I don't see any reason why at this point. This is a perfectly fine answer, and that's it.